everyone, welcome back to my channels. It's been a while, I think more than two weeks, I guess. I haven't produced any videos. So what happened is I'm upgrading and reconfig all my cockpit or multi-function cockpit basically. So let me go through with it. What changes, what stays actually. In front of me there's a 60-inch TV monitors. And I'm using Track IR, if you can see over there, so I can move my head. Of course, I'm using a head-mounted webcam just for easy recording. On the left side, there's another 4K. So basically 4K 60-inch. This one is 4K 50-inch. Used to be my main monitors or my main screen last time, but now it's becoming a secondary monitor for the main PC. So both of them are using the main PC with AMD 5950X and RTX 3080 non-TI. So basically, as you can see, I'm running several software here. Of course, the FS2020 and then the spat.next. So I just recently set everything into my spat.next. I will create another video on how to set it up, and also using Track IR and actually auto hotkey to configure several of my key. So on the right side I have a smaller 4K. It's a Samsung monitors UD590, I think, that will fit through my second PC or recording PC. So I'm running OBS and also Voice Meter Potato, and all the sound will coming from this, and video actually feed through using a video captures into this second PC. In front of me there are several things. Of course, the Thrustmasters Pilot A3 or Airbus Pilot joystick. This is mainly for Airbus. And then this is my HTG button box DIY. So this is for mostly for setting up view, and this one to answer ATC on FS2020. But I'm now kind of not using ATC from FS2020. I'm using Pilot to ATC. This in front of me, there's several panels below, actually DIY for a small plane like Cessna or something. With the throttle here, as you can see, throttle quadrant, propeller mix, and several buttons here. This one is a magneto switch. This is the old one, but I'm no longer using it right now at this moment. The top one is actually my yoke, a DIY yoke. So this one is actually a yoke for Airbus or for Boeing or small plane. DIY. This one is of course Thrustmaster Cougar displays. I'm using several buttons for my A320 setup later on. So this one is the FCU panels, mainly for A320. So you can see the FCU panel, and this one is of course the Honeycomb Bravo. This one is Honeycomb Bravo throttle quadrants. I'm using this for my Boeing together with my of course with my yoke, and then but again I can use several key here during setup with, let's say, for Airbus. I'm using this for several button here for radio setting with this multi rotary switch and several setting here. In the far right actually there's a gear lever for Airbus, but yeah, I can use that for other aircraft, and this one is provided in from Honeycomb. On my right side there's a Thrustmaster throttle quadrants, this Airbus one, and this one is a DIY pedestal that I've created mostly mainly for Airbus, and yeah, so it's actually 3D printed. And actually it's mechanically imitating the real one. Okay, parking brake and everything. Okay, so I'm using trackball here to control my second PC. I'm using PC mouse mouse for the main PC, but and several switches like this one is for audio. Switching my audio channel through like a filtration to create a radio effect or something like that. The latest addition actually above here, this is my overhead panels, which actually it's quite been a while. I haven't been able to complete it, but in the past 2 weeks I've completed this one. It's for Adair, for example. It's not really a one-to-one replica, but the function here are replicating most of the overhead switches. So this one is for, let's say, for a gear taxi using the Airbus approach, but I can use it for, let's say, Boeing or any other aircraft. Okay, so this is my setup. This one is using MMJoy, of course. This one is using MMJoy, and all DIY is actually using MMJoy except for the branded one like Honeycomb and of course Thrustmaster. So the other addition actually, or combination actually, this keyboard. This actually a cash register keyboard for in a supermarket. You've probably seen it quite often. I bought this from AliExpress. This is previously used for me to control audio, like sound pad, so I can play certain audio effect. I can make a label here and then put under this transparent plastic cap, so I can label it individually. But at this setting, I'm using this to simulate the MacDo or the basically the CDU of the aircraft or the airline. So this one is based on Airbus. You can make two data in it, flight plan. You can, and this alphanumeric and numeric, and this is the cursors, and this is the left and right screen, kind of button. So this one will be used to kind of typing in the MacDo without even using any mouse. So the idea today is really actually to show you that I can basically fly with less or minimal mouse interactions. Okay, because sometimes if you use Track IR, for example, using your mouse to control or to turn the knobs or press the button is quite difficult, because when you want to turn, you have to stabilize your view, and if you're moving around, your mouse will not hitting the right key, right? So that's, I experienced that it's becoming useless using Track IR with the mouse, because, but then I need the Track IR because in the 2D versions of this cockpit, I still need to move around kind of freely left and right, right? So today I'm going to show you with A32NX mod aircraft, I can try to simulate piloting the aircraft without or less mouse interactions. Okay, so let's go in and start the demonstrations. Okay. Okay, hi everyone. So we are in the cockpit right now. I'm not going to go through a complete procedures right now, just to want to show you on how I'm using my cockpit. So here we are in Gatwick. Our plan was to fly from Gatwick into Eham in Netherlands, Amsterdam. So here we are using A320neo or A32NX by fly-by-wire sim. This is development versions. I haven't updated to the latest one. I'm using the add-on from Gatwick, but I think this one is not the free one. But yeah, the jetway is missing, as you can see. Unfortunately, there's still some bugs, so we are not going to go through a normal procedure. So what I would like to show you basically is how I'm going to operate the plane without the or with minimal mouse interaction. There are some gadget like this electronic fly EFB, which I cannot use shortcut buttons, so I need to use the mouse, but the rest I think mostly without the mouse. So let's start from checking up, so I can check my physical kiosome. Parking brake off, flap up, spoiler disarm, engine start switch off, ignition normal. I think that one, the gear lever down, this one not set, and of course everything not set here, so everything off except for wiper. I still cannot bind the switch, so but that's it. So let's switch on, so we can take a look at the battery. It's 27.6 volt, so it should be okay. So I'm pushing the switch for battery 1, battery 2. Actually we can go external power directly without battery actually. So external power in, everything set up. So I bind the key to my overhead panels over there, and this things, the Kogar MFD buttons, I set up for several things. So this one is for the overhead light, so I can try to turn the light here by pressing up button, and this one is the upper ECAM, and this one is the PFD, so you can see the PFD is going up if I press this button, so it's light up. This one also ND, so it's brighten up the ND, and upper ECAM, let's brighten up upper ECAM, and also lower ECAM, brighten up lower ECAM switch. Okay, so it's mostly in the middle right now, and this one is actually FCU backlit, so let's turn up and crank up the FCU backlit, and also FCU display, let's brighten up a bit FCU display. And we have several other lights here, like the float light here, the main light here, we can try to look at it. As you can see, the main integrated light is up, and we can push here actually to PFD first officers to light up together with the ND to 50%. So you can see it's a bit dim, so if I press this one it will make it brighter immediately. And I can turn it off actually by using this button here. If I want to turn it off and I want to turn it on, I just press one button, so I don't need to brighten up their display manually. And float light, increase the float light so it's brighter, and float light for pedestal, that increase over there next to the ATC panel. Okay, I think that's it. And actually I can bind the switch actually for the cockpit light. If I put this one, that will be cabin light on. This is supposed to be 50% and this one is off. Okay, so that's it. So lights has been set up, and I think we can continue to the setting up the, oh sorry, one more before that. This is the only, if you can see, I need the mouse to activate this. I still cannot find the variables to switch it on. So if I found it, I might put a button to turn it off, turn it on and off without the mouse. But today I'm going still using a mouse. And sometimes the mouse still a backup here if the, because sometimes it's crash on spot.next stop functioning, and I can still use my mouse to operate just for a backup. Okay, so once you finish this, the next one, I think you still have to do a preparation still, not going yet in MacDo. The first one is this oxygen, crew oxygen, so let's press this one. Okay, so crew oxygen in the screen, as you can see, is lights off or normal or auto. And you can take a look at audios up there. I can turn this switch here. Audios 1, audios 2, and audios 3. Okay, so I'm not touching any mouse. I'm usually make it very quick today just to show you slowly what happens. So this one is for nav lights. Okay, nav lights is on, And then this one I still have to set up into strobe to auto. Today is directly to on. I need to put it in auto. And beacon, actually I can turn it out later, but for the sake I'm going to turn on the beacon. This one is for the seat belt if you want to turn it now on it now. Okay, and this, the ding sound is coming up. This one is for the non-smoking. Okay, so it's on auto, and this one is for emergency sign to auto or arm actually. Okay, so that's it. So that is the first preparations that you need to do here, and we're gonna do that later on. And you can also try to push the here. I put a sorry, let me fix the view. Here, if you can see the APU, and I can actually press this button. Let's say I'm putting here the press this one. So fire test, look at the dashboard, and if you want to look other way you can, and you release the pressing on this, and you can also test the engine one. So on, there's a warning sign, upper ECAM, and next to the ignition switch. And third one here, right engine, similar things. And you can check your warning in the dashboard, your top ECAM, and then next to the ignitions. Okay, so by having the button, you don't have to kind of take a look at it and try to hold the mouse, and you can just press it with your hands directly to the button. So this is very intuitive, very helpful. You don't have to kind of arrange a few, which is impossible using the 2D cockpit right now. So that is the test, and you're ready to go to make do. The other things you want to try setting up is this. Let's put out the sim brief here on the, as you can see, there's a 1021, that's the altimeter setting, the barometric setting. I already uploaded from SimBrief. We're going to fly from EGKK to EHAM. So this is the panel, this is the only panel that I'm using a mouse here. Okay, so I'm using this button box to switch into flypad, and then this one into MacDo, this one into center panel, this one into the PFD-ND, this one into like a side view, and this one is actually to the FCU, this one is actually to the top overhead, this one is the around the throttle area, and this one is the lower buttonmost pedestal, and this one is actually for the passenger view, and the rest is just, you know, I'm setting this button box to press several view basically. Okay, so if I want to go back, I can just press a button here on my Thrustmaster stick to center my view back to the normal or default view, which is looking forward. Okay, so that's quickly on how I set the basic buttons. So let's go into the MacDo and use the keyboard here to program it. Okay, so let's go here, and now it's a MacDo. I'm gonna freeze the view on the, I'm using this button to freeze my track IR. So let's freeze it, and I'm gonna slide away so to the right so you can see what happens. Okay, so here, if you can see in the camera on the left, I'm gonna touch this keyboard to control the MacDo on the screen. For example, if I put this L1, it will go to data page and immediately show the configuration of the aircraft. But we won't do that first, because we're gonna get initializations on the so ATSU, and then AOC menu, and then we're going to do a init request, which is actually getting the data from SimBrief, and we're going to press this right button 5 or R5 here to request from SimBrief. Okay, so we're gonna request from SimBrief. So now you can see it's already on the screens, the EGKK or Echo Golf Kilo Kilo and Echo Hotel Alpha Mike, our destinations, and Brussels actually our alternate, not here, but you're gonna see it in the init page. So we're gonna go back to AOC menu. We can go to performance and weight and balance. I'm still using the old version, so it's still not accurate. Not every payload is being loaded, but the latest version, I think they already fixed it. So this one is still not correct, but it's okay. It's for this purpose of the video, and let's load. So it will be updating the payload based on the SimBrief now. Okay. So once I set up this area, actually I'm already finished and can go to, let's say, data page again to start the proper initialization. So this one is checking all the engine type, navigation database correct, idle performance correct, blah, blah, blah. And I can clear it out first. And then let's go to the second page, which is the init page. And init page, you're gonna take it from the SimBrief here, so just press this one and it will fill up for you, which is the Echo Golf Kilo Kilo toward Echo Hotel Alpha Mike and Echo Bravo Bravo Romeo for our alternate, and our flight number is British Airways 542. Okay, so Speedbird 542. Cost index is 40, and then flight level 310 and the rest. Okay, so this is done for the init. I can just clear it up, and then you go next page. So I'm arranging this key. If you can see here, it's actually already using a diff rip approach, so not following the key in the real keypad, but this is MacDo menu, data, init, flight plan, secondary flight plan, rat nav, init page B, fuel prediction, performance, ATC com program, and direct button. So basically I programmed this already following this scripts for convenience. So if I forget, I could just follow the sequence without remembering on which button in the MacDo to press next. So for even if the init page B here already setting up, so if I press this, it goes directly to init page B rather than init plus the next page button. Okay, so this is very convenient. So let's say I've done with the init now. Let's say go to F flight plan. So now it's in the flight plan EGKK. So let's do setting up the departures. Press left one here, and then we going to go to runway 26 left, which is L4 here. So select 26 left, and then select the basically going up to this cursor up and select Fran 1 mic is the one, the SID that we're going to use. Select L5 here, and that's it. So already set Fran or 1M or one mic. So let's put this insert here, R6, and that's it. So you can see it's already set up for our SID or standard instrument departure. The next one that we have to set is basically the destination or arrival, which is EHAM or Echo Hotel Alpha mic in the L6 here. Let's press, and then you press the arrival here, and you're gonna select ILS 27. Okay, so L5 here. Okay, and then you're gonna select star or standard approach terminal or rifle, RAT F1 alpha. So this one is L4. So let's select. And you're gonna select Sugol as your transition here, or this one is L5, and then that's it. So that is set, and then insert. Okay, so basically you already set up everything here in the flight plan. Now, the nice thing here also, usually you're gonna check in the display, right? So if you're gonna do here and then release the view, so if you want to check, usually you need to set to the flight plan. So I'm gonna switch this on to flight plan here, so you can see there's a button here. So it's going to show the flight plan, and let's say you want to 40 mile setting. So I'm going to use this button also, and this is 40 mile setting on the flight plan. Then you can press this upper button without even looking at the MCDU. Let's say I'm going to look at very close here. So I'm going to go up, let's say I'm going to start from here on Gatwick, and then going up to Acorn, DVR 32, Frayn, Spear, Tofku, and Daga, Gaza, Ratlow, Redfa, and Sulut, and Sugal is our transition to Star, and then entering the approach leg toward runway ILS runway 27. So seems to be okay. And we can go back and then trying to go back to ARC here and then put 10 miles back. So it's already back to ARC without even touching the mouse. Okay, so this is how I set up. What else? I think done with the flight plan, and usually I'm requesting IFR clearance for now. And let's see what we get, but we know that for this SID we need to fly to, if you can see in the screen over there, we need to get into 4,000 feet first, between 3,200 to 4,000 feet, and then 5,000 at Acorn and DVR and Detling and Frayn. We are transitioning at 6,000, so I know I need to go to 4,000, so I'm setting the 4,000 here on my FCU panel, and as you can see it's a basically I can rotate here, and this is 4,000. Okay, the speed usually it's 220 knots, so but I can setting up later on during the first leg or the airborne phase, when I already airborne and then the autopilot take over. Usually it's deleting my settings, so then by then I can set for 220 knots. Okay, the other things, looking at the flight path, we know that the altimeter barometric setting is 1021, so if you can see here is 1013. I can set here in using this one to set up my 1021. Okay, 1021. So basically I've already set up the correct barometric altimeters. The only thing here that I cannot set is ISIS. So here the ISIS, I still cannot find the bound key or the variables to set this manually. So if you want to set this one to proper one, you still have to use the mouse, unfortunately. So this one is another instrument that I haven't been able to figure out for the key setting using Sputnex. So we'll probably get back later on. So this is setting up already, I think quite proper, and we can already start boarding and everything, and you want to start the APU, right? Because now you're ready to put your passenger in, and let's press this because we already fired test. Now we can start the master APU switch here. Okay, as you can see the master APU on, and you can see below the screen, actually in the normal flight I don't see above my head, so I kind of take a look, but looking at the bottom and while try to press the master key, so it's kind of reflex, very fast move without trying to look at it and trying to use the mouse. So flap open already in the screen, as you can see. Now we are ready to press the start button here on this panel. I can press this one, and it will start the APU. So you can see the APU is pulling up, AGT is rising, 400 more, 500 above, 600 above, and the N% is actually increasing 32, 33, and up to 100%. Okay, so once 100%, the APU is ready, and we can start for preparing the pushback. Meanwhile, we can take a look at, let's say, the engine. Here I'm setting this button here for the ACAS or the lower ECAM setting. Like for this one, if you can see, is looking at the engine. So this one engine, this one is a bleed, cabin pressures, electrical here, so it's charging. You see the DC battery is charging, and this one is a hydraulic. I think its pressure is all good. Not yet, because it's not pressurizing yet. And this one is the fuel. You have all those 5.3 ton or 5,300 kilograms, and it seems to be balanced. This one, the oil page, you see that oil page, you see it's all showing oil, so it's good sequencing. Here the bottom one is the APU, so you can see the APU here, the air conditioning, door, wheel, flight control, and this is the clear button. This is the, if you want to look at the status, let's say this is the status page, and recall, there's no recall basically, so it's okay. So basically I can take a look at the ECAM here using this control in my Thrustmaster Koguard. Okay, so basically everything is already 100%. If I put in the APU, you can see it's already 100% here. So we're ready to press the APU bleed. So I'm gonna press the APU bleed here, and it's the sound of the APU entering, and I can turn off this external power. And I forgot to switch on the fuel. So if you press this one, two, center tank, center pump, right pump. So everything is set up here for the fuel pump. Okay, so that's done. I think it's the upper panel mostly okay. Let me check. Yeah, except for the air conditioning, I don't have the key, and the wiper is not yet functioning here. So, but the rest actually, including the pack button, actually working. Okay, so I'm done with this setting. Now we can continue to first with this MacDo, because we haven't finished. So next, after flight plan, is actually secondary flight plan, but nothing here, not yet defined. RatNav, I'm checking, actually we are supposed to have the frequency for it's actually not 11090, right? So let's say we want to have, actually as in the Navigraph chart, is actually 111.55. So I'm gonna put 111.55. I'm going to enter L4 here, L3 for the ILS frequency, so it's set up properly for EHEM. Okay, so that's done. So next page is after RatNav is actually init page B. Take a look at this. When I press this one, it immediately goes to init page B rather than I'm pressing some other button. So it goes to initially to directly to init page B. So that's very convenient. So now I'm gonna put the zero fuel weight. So I'm gonna press this R1 and put it back again to R1. Okay, block fuel we know is 5.3, and we're gonna put it R2. Okay, so I know it will be tailwind 23 knots. So I'm gonna put 23 into R5. So it would be tailwind 23 knots. Okay, once the init page speed done, we next is fuel prediction here. Just to summarize, your extra time, gross weight, center gravity to 1.8. Basically, you can calculate, let's say, the setting for your elevator's trim, for takeoff trim. But unfortunately, at this moment, I didn't use my calculator. But usually, I use the calculator to take out the, to get the several data again for performance later on. Okay, so once the fuel prediction done, the next page actually here is the performance. So if you click, it goes directly to the performance. Flex time, yes, you have to use calculator. Then you, but yeah, we don't gonna demonstrate it today. We're gonna use flap one plus F. So one, you put into R3 here, which is flaps one. For V1, you're gonna press this L1 here. You get 1, 2, 2, and you press again V1, VR 1, 2, 3, and you put again on VR, V2 1, 2, 7. Again, you put it into V2. The other one is actually, we know our transition altitude is 6,000 in Gatwick or London area, and then put it at L4. Okay, so we complete the performance page right now, and the rest actually is optional. What you can do is basically you can go back and release your track IR again and try to look at several page here. You can take a look at the door, probably already closed, so ready to for taxi. Right, so you put usually put into flight control page to check your flight control later on. So before that, there are several things you're going to activate. I'm going to activate the ATC switch here, which going to switch this ATC switch over there from standby to auto. So if I flick this one, if you can see, I flick this one on the lower camera, it will immediately switch the standby to on. Okay, so just to show you that I'm setting it up. What else that I need to check and to set? I think I'm done with most of it, and I'm ready for pushback. So for pushback, I can use basically a mouse again. Unfortunately, I haven't bound any kind of, I can bound actually several, but I need some programming basically. So let's say start pushback, and let's say put tuck speed over here. I haven't released my parking brake, but it will probably release, so I need to release parking brake. Okay, parking brake release. Oops, so it's already like moving by itself, because I already put the move, so the tug is a bit left behind. There will come, no worries about it. Okay, so before that, I'm gonna close the door. I forgot to close the door, so if I press this red button here, it will show the camera over there. You can see there's a camera in the lower E-cam. If I press again, the door is locked. Okay, the other things that I'm going to press is this switch here. It's actually for predictive wind shear predictive PWS or predictive wind shear systems, but I'm going to press it later on when we are already ready for taxi. Okay, so here we are at Gatwick, so we can take a look, and I think we all can already start to turn. I'm going to use rudder here just for the sake of the control. Now I'm ready. I got a clearance to start up the engine, so I already fire test the engine. Now I'm going to switch this switch to ignition start. Okay, as you can see, it's actually start, and then flick the second start engine over there, as you can see. And I can see here on the screen, usually I can show the engine first, Seems to be going up. The engine below is not updated. Okay, so N1 is increasing, PSI increasing, N1, N2. Okay, so seems to be okay. So let's continue with the pushback, because it's still far away. Okay, so here the engine is ramping up. You can hear the sound, like 500 EGT rising. 10 N1 is 10%, 12%. N2 is already like almost 60%. Okay, so first engine is available. So let's put to flick this left engine up. Left engine is running, so I'm not using any mouse until today except for the ISIS and the EFB, electronic flight back. And using this track IR is quite convenient because you can see around without needing to use the mouse also to change the view. Okay, so that is Gatwick mod. Unfortunately, the jetway is missing. I don't know, I haven't really updated this mod either, so I think the free one is good. This one is the payware one. Okay, so we are still behind, so I'm gonna... Okay, so seems to be N1 is reaching 16%, so it's okay. EGT is down from 600 to 500-ish available. So now engine both are available. We can turn off the APU. I'm gonna press this APU bleed off and APU master off. So basically I'm running with the engine now on the electricity and everything. So APU has been turned off. Now I'm going to complete my pushback. I'm turning too early, I guess. So here's the yellow line. Usually you do talk to ATC to get the clearance on the, you know, taxi and runway, but at this moment I'm not going to use the ATC because I'm using pilot to ATC right now, no longer FS2020 ATC. I think it's not really working well. Sometimes it's missing, sometimes it's broken, so yeah, it's not good. So let's put the brake here first. Let's put and push back, and that's it. Okay, so we complete the... So let's say when we request for taxi, we need to set up for takeoff anyway, right? So first of all, you press the max, the button here to put the auto brake to max. So auto brake to max. And then you put TCAS to auto, so you can see that's flick the TCAS. And windshield prediction to on here, and flick this button. You can see it's windshield prediction on. So everything is parking brake still okay. So you can see in the lower ECAM it's already show, upper ECAM is already takeoff configuration. So furthermore, I need to set up my flap. Okay, flap here to 1. And spoiler to arm. And as you can see, it's already set properly. And we can actually start moving. Okay, during the taxi we can then ding the cabin, and and press takeoff config here to confirm that we are ready for takeoff. But before we taxi, we're going to turn on the taxi light here. Okay, taxi light on. As you can see, the light's on. I think that's it. Okay, so we are now ready to taxi. Let's put on off the parking brake and let's move. So usually you get the taxi clearance first, but this time we're not gonna do that for our purpose today. Hopefully there's no crash. Sometimes, you know, I think first of all you cannot add any controller while you are already in simulations. If you add new controller in the middle of the flight, you're gonna risk of crashing, you know, crash to desktop basically. So brake check, clear left side, clear right side of course, and you can change into flight control view. Sorry, I need to do this first rather than later. So put it the flight control, and then you can try to do full left, full right, and then full up, full down, rudder full left, rudder full right. Okay, so that's it. So I'm done. So I can continue again. Either you can use the flight control or you can just show the engine here. So I'm gonna turn here toward the 26 left, clear left side. Okay, runway 26 left is actually in front of us, to the left, the starting point to the left. Okay, so hope it's going to be quite a smooth experience today. I'm not going to do a full flight today, so just take off and trying to climb to our cruise flight level or to transition, but that's it. And it's a similar concept when you've you know, on arrival or approach a sequence, using this controller is really, really nice. Okay, so you can ding the cabin now because it's already ready for, you can press this button here. Sorry guys, there are some disturbance. I forgot to check my camera. Seems to be freeze on the upper left camera or my head mounted camera. Now I can press and ding the cabin here using this button here.
Flight attendants, please prepare for takeoff.
So I already announced, and you can see in the ECAM page, an upper one is already almost done except for the config, takeoff config. So I can press this button here to press takeoff config. So all green, no blue. Okay, so basically you are ready, and here we can okay, let me, I think we can try to turn just right into this app. Usually you give an instruction by ATC, right? This one is Alpha Sierra Taxiway. I think this is the closest one to the runway, Alpha Sierra. Okay, so that is our entrance over there. We cannot cross that red light zone. You can take that taxiway actually, a bit more easier because it's kind of a sharp turn to the right. But you're gonna stop around this light first because we cannot cross that light before we got clearance, okay, from tower. So we're gonna stop here. Now we are trying to enter the runway. We can go to the next one to get to the longest part of the runway. Okay, so let's put the parking brake first. Let's prepare for takeoff. Now For takeoff, the only thing is just to check everything set. I think okay, everything seems to be set. Of course, you can play the radio here. I put here the radio. This one is for changing the frequency. If you can see the frequency here change. Let me check. I think you cannot see it because it's kind of like I'm putting the setting here for the frequency. If you can see, I'm changing. Just to show you a bit, this is the frequency setting going up, and then if I change for the lower, I can change the fraction of it. Okay, I can push this button to transfer from standby to active from this one. Right now is for VHF 1. So that's the setting on frequency, but I'm not going to use today because we haven't set for ATC. I'm going to prepare for takeoff, which is turning on this landing lights on and then put two on. Okay, and then this taxi lights on, it will light up everything for us. Be ready. And the other one is I'm going to turn off the pack for takeoff. I'm going to press this one and the pack is off, pack 2 also off for takeoff, for conserving the energy. And that's it. We are ready for takeoff. Then you ask for clearance, got the clearance, and then parking brake off, and you can enter the runway when you get clearance. Okay, clear left side, clear right side, of course, from your first officers. Unfortunately, this development version, we cannot put any first officer body, so there's a missing body over there. Unfortunately, I hope they're gonna create a first officer. And I hope it was kind of high resolutions. I don't know if that aircraft is landing or not because we didn't get any clearance directly from ATC. I hope that plane is not landing directly. So we're gonna line up here on the runway. Okay. Okay, so let's put 50%. Takeoff, ready for takeoff? Takeoff. So put the joystick a bit low. And now I'm gonna put into toga. SRS, runway auto thrust, blue. Manual toga, man toga, SRS, runway auto thrust blue. So V1 VR rotates, so forget to call out that one. Positive climb, gear up. Okay, and then I'm gonna press AP1 on. I'm gonna follow the now, and then also flap 0, and we already above 1500. Then we put into climb idle thrust, and we're gonna set the speed into 220 because that's the max allowed in this area. So 220 set, so I'm not going to exceed 220 by turning this knob here for the speed on the FCU panels. So they're gonna stay on 220 right now because that is the given speed at this moment. And after takeoff checklist, gear up, flap up or zero, and then spoiler disarm. That's a very close nearby aircraft. Okay, so we're gonna switch on the packs on check. So now we are configured for a climb. I think after, let me check the, sorry, here until Deadling D29, we can already climb to 5,000. So let's do 5,000 here. Okay, so let's put 1500 vertical speed. So we're gonna climb to 5,000. A bit late, but it's okay. Okay, we're gonna climb to 5,000. That's the scenery. So far so good, no crash. Sometimes using third party software like spot.next, SimConnect sometimes kind of a bit weird, or you know, get some. So you can put here to 40 mile, for example. You can see the whole flight plan over there, Acorn. So Acorn, Delta, DVR 3-2 over there, and Deadling and Frayne transition 6,000. Okay, so we reach 5,000 altitude setting. System check, engine okay. It's a air conditioning display here. This is the progress page on the flight phase. We are in a climb mode right now, climb phase. Very nice early morning in UK. So it's a bit cloudy and rainy down there, but here is pretty nice weather. Okay, we can turn off the taxi light, and also it turn off the landing light automatically. Of course, usually you done it above 10,000, but it's okay. Just to show you that this switch is working, and yep, so the rest is switch are pretty okay. You can play around and check the engine, bleed air is okay, and cabin pressure is supposed to be fine. Trickle not charging, so it's okay. Hydraulic now all green, as you can see, it's functional. Pressures, fuel, we can already use 200 kg or 400 kg already consumed. Yeah, and what else? I think back to air conditioner page, or you can put all page just to show everything here. Okay, you can put an engine one. Okay, so now we are close to our Deadling and Frayne transition waypoint. After that, we're gonna climb into 310 flight level as our target of cruise flight level. There's some traffic over there on our left. There's a light over there in the cloud. So it's very nice. I mean, I show you slowly at this moment, but once you get into the real flight, you're gonna not gonna look into overhead panel or to your switches. You just do it and your eyes can keep looking in front of you. Unfortunately, I think this is the transition setup before you go into a full cockpit setup. I wish I can build a full cockpit setup someday later for A320 kind of aircraft. Until then, this is very good and I can program this. Actually, this is much better because all the switch here I can configure into Dreamliner 787, for example, or CRJ or whatever aircraft that I want. if you have a full cockpit setup, a really replica cockpit, the problem with that, you only can fly with one models, right? So that is the caveat or the drawbacks of using dedicated cockpits. Multifunction cockpit like this, you can configure. I've configured this one actually for 787. Some of them is still in progress of programming the key. But yeah, the rest, I can utilize my Honeycomb instead of my Thrustmaster Quadrant down here. For let's say Boeing 787, for example. Okay, so and I can still use my yoke here and for the 787, or even I can utilize some of the panels here for controlling some more if I require to. Okay, so that's the beauty of this multifunction cockpit rather than a dedicated cockpit. Because if you are bored flying, getting bored flying one aircraft, you can switch to the other aircraft easily by just selecting or automatically selecting the profile in spot.next setup. Okay, so I'm gonna have a video later on how to create a spot.next profile, so we can automatically switch between profile seamlessly. By the way, in the Microsoft 2020, I set the controller profile to nothing, to zero setting. So I didn't put any setting in the profile inside FS 2020 except for several things. The axis mostly, and some buttons that I haven't migrated from the FS 2020 to spot.next. But once you set up all everything in spot.next, you can have zero controller or setting in FS 2020. I think it helps on the multi-controller setup, because if you set up every controller inside FS 2020, it's gonna load the FS 2020 and create a very laggy responses. Okay, so you cannot, I've experienced very difficult setting inside FS 2020. Using spot.next is external, so it's only setting the SIM config as necessary, so they don't have to poll the controller, including in the FS 2020. So I'm not setting to 6000. Let's say I'm gonna okay, so it's oops, sorry, I'm gonna fly 1500 feet FS vertical speed. So now they're climbing to 6000, hopefully hit frame by 6000 here by frame. So see about that. So by then, now we are ready to put back into autopilot or flight plan and climb to 310. Okay, so now we are reaching 6000 at frame, so ready to, so you can call ATC and you reach frame, one mic, and ready for just report to ATC and then give you a clearance to higher level. Okay, so basically you get a clearance and now you get into your flight cruise level. Okay, let's say 310, and then you're gonna set up the climb into 1800 feet per minute. Okay, so now you're climbing to, then you can put the speed into program mode. Actually, I forgot, after DVR or D29er, actually I can already goes to 250, but I forget to release it 250. But now they can go to 310 knots, or at least to 51st below 10,000. So here, because we are still below 10,000 feet, so it's limited to 250. Once we pass 10,000, we can actually go faster to 310 usually. the program speed. Okay, so let's see. So we're still climbing with decent rate of climb, so we can actually try to climb fast, so let's say to 2100 feet per minute. So we are now close to 10,000, as you can see. Okay, so we are in the middle of the sandwich between clouds, upper cloud and lower cloud level. So very cloudy morning. Okay, now we almost 9500 feet, 6900 feet, 99, so 10,000. Now they're gonna push the speed to 310, as you can see in the PFD. Now it's setting to 310. We can turn the seatbelt off, and 310. We can still keep the climb rate over there. Okay, not 310 actually, 290. We only given a 290 speed. Or 526 Mach. Okay, so one more thing you can do actually after transition is actually put the standard altimeter. So here I program the switch here. If I press this one, it's set to standard. Okay, so basically you can reach all the control without even touching the mouse here, and already set to standard. Now above, let's say usually in the US above 18,000 feet, I think in UK is the 6,000 feet, that's our transitions, and then new standard or above 10,000 feet definitely. I need to take a look at the standard again. Okay, so basically that's it. We've done the, and you can put the ignition to normal mode. Except if you go to heavy cloud, thunderstorm or something, you can put the ignition switch into start ignition. So okay, so that's it guys. I think I'm not gonna continue the full flight here, but as you can see, I just show you on how to control everything from the overhead pedal here, and then using this keyboard here, the cash register keyboard, to control MacDo and several DIY FCU. It's a basic one even without the 7-segment display here, just the controller or the input. And this one is Thrustmaster Koguard for me to control several buttons. This is DIY button box for my view, and several buttons around, pedestal and everything, you know. So this one also being used, some button here being used to control something else, and even this one is for the radio, as you already can see before. Okay, I haven't used this one, I haven't used this button yet in the flap here, and I can still do several things. And even this one, I forgot to set up the elevator trim. I can use this to trim the elevators, and I can still have more buttons down there to, if you lack of button. But I still already feel enough button, except if there are some other panels in the overhead that you need to bind again. I still have this button here not used, and of course this wiper button is not used, so I still have several button here unused. But the rest, this one is for anti-ice, so I can, let's say, put wing anti-ice on. You can see in the screen. This one is for engine 1, engine 2 anti-ice, or I can turn off the anti-ice. Okay, so that's already bind. A chrono, I also bind chrono. Actually, this one is for chrono. You see the chronometer is starting. I can stop it, I can turn it off. This several button is warning, caution, and terrain button here. I can press it also from this. So almost all the button in A32NX aircraft has been mapped. Although several button I didn't like, those switching on the ACAS system, of course, and the comms. The comms, I don't have all the buttons bind because I rarely use the comm anyway. But once they come alive, I can try to put it some buttons somewhere down below here if I need to. But yeah, at this moment, I think for just a normal flight today, I don't need that. Okay, so I hope you can see how fluent by binding all this key, physical key, without using a mouse. So very intuitive, very fluent. So the other problem when you accept, let's say when you land you have successfully land, you have to when you try to exit the runway, you need to switch off the light, for example, if you don't use FS2 crew push button or the first officer's automated sequence. You won't get help to turn off the light, right? So you can turn off the light using this overhead button, or you can turn off the taxi light when you enter the ramp, so you don't blind the marshal over there. And you can start the APU when you are taxi toward the runway. You can try to turn off the left engine or right engine or single engine taxi, for example. Yes, you can do it immediately without trying to tumble around the view and trying to get the mouse click, and you forgot, and try not to look ahead. By doing this one, you can just glimpse and try to press whatever you need, and while your eyes still looking in front of the taxiway or steering the aircraft. So that is giving me a bit more fluent experience compared to limited 2D using a mouse control. Okay, so I hope that's giving you enough view on how I'm using this whole setup. I'm going to talk about the SpotNut next later on, because that require a very in-depth setting, and I can share my setting because I found a lot of setting variables very difficult to understand. I've tried to find it myself, and some looking from other reference, from Sebastian, from MobiFlight, and other people who already created the setting, and from SpotNut themselves already provided a lot of kind of event or variable access, very easy to read compared to FSUI PC7. Okay, so that's it in the video, and hopefully that gives you a bit more ideas. Okay, see you.